Variety hailed her as a modern phenomenon. Newsweek magazine referred to her as possibly the most spontaneous force in all of Videoland. And Ms. Magazine described her as the woman who turned a conventional talk show into a distinctive hour of laughing, crying, hollering, hugging, and sharing. Well, if you haven't been home weekday mornings at 9 to watch Oprah Winfrey on Channel 2, take a moment to sit back and see what all the fuss is about.
The theme music doesn't warn you about what you're going to see.
So I raised my children, and I didn't need some damn pablum puking dame to tell me how to do it.
$150, and now I'm making $13 an hour.
Every morning since September, millions across America have been treated to a dazzling display of human emotion, a battlefield with Oprah caught in the crossfire.
This is really something. I've raised 6 kids, and you don't got any?
Go to Pastor Miles' farm in Michigan, plan meetings and plan events,
Bull.
Come back to Marquette Park,
Bull.
And incite race riots.
That is a lie, and I'll
tapes.
Ram it down
I've
your
got
throat
tapes from
right
your
in your
meeting,
face.
Sir.
Please help me to try to understand this.
Like her close competitor, Phil Donahue, Oprah treats her audience to an eclectic array of subjects. For example, men who wear women's clothes. To men and women who like to wear no clothes at all.
How do you decide to become a nudist? I mean, what happens in your life that just one day you want to take off your clothes?
I don't know for everyone, but for me, we found out about it by mistake. A friend of mine told me.
But what makes Oprah different from Donahue is her style. For example, Oprah doesn't prepare for interviews.
So I've gotten a really bad rap, I think, unfortunately, because I was honest with the media and said, you know, I really don't do a lot of homework, which doesn't mean that I'm stupid or that I am a person who lacks preparation. My feeling is, if you have read every possible thing about a guest, then, and you know all the answers, then your questions are totally different than a person who's just naturally curious.
And if she's curious, the emotional buildup is as surprising to her as it is to the audience. And she doesn't hesitate to show her feelings.
So it's pretty hard. I hope it works out. I'm trying. I asked him today if he wants to work it out, and he says no.
Oof.
And I got 2 small kids. And...
Oh, boy. Okay, I'll
Steve,
wait.
I want to tell you that I love you, because I know you're watching, and I don't want to get a divorce, and I'm not cheating on you, and I think the world of you. And this has been inside of me, and I had to get it out. I love you with all my heart.
Sometimes, though, the weight of the human condition gets to even the tough-skinned nature of this seasoned TV personality.
It's got to be a pretty frightening thing when you're 9 years old and your father has sexual intercourse with you. I know it's hard to tell. I really do. I understand how hard it is to talk about.
The audience would find out in a minute why Oprah was so moved.
Tell me, were you sexually abused by a member of your family?
My father.
So this is your father's child?
Mm-hmm. Yes. It happened very frequently, as with Lori also, practically every day when my mother would go to work. One of the most horrible experiences that I can remember was...
Take your time.
We're going to take a break.
Oprah Winfrey would later reveal to the world that a cousin had sexually abused her as a child.
I had this feeling, as you talked about it, that this was the first time you had talked about it with anyone.
Yeah, that's true, Monica. That's true. And one of the reasons why I did it at that time was because I, was interviewing these people who had been sexually abused, and I didn't want people to think that I was being exploited and that I was trying to be sensationalist and, you know, just trying to get people to cry. I wanted people to know that it is a problem that has affected a lot of people, including myself.
I had a feeling it was the first time, too, your dad and your mom probably knew
mm-hmm.
about it.
That's true, too. That's true. My father wasn't aware of it at all, and we have yet to talk about it. He said to me just the other day, you know, we're going to have to, you know, sit down and have one of those father-daughter talks and talk about, you know, this just with ourselves.
But it sounds like it's something that's going to be difficult for you to talk to your dad about.
I think it is. Isn't it amazing? I can talk to the whole world about it, And every time my daddy said, well, you know, when can we sit down and talk? I say, oh, Dad, well, you know, I'm so busy. Look, things are just really busy right now. So, yeah, I think it's going to be really difficult.
Her father did find out about the sexual abuse, as you may have, in a national magazine. In fact, you could not avoid reading the life story of this poor girl born of a broken home on a Mississippi farm 32 years ago. She was reared by her grandmother.
Do you think maybe too much has been made of the fact that, you know, you were born out of wedlock?
Oh, absolutely, Monica. I'm so glad you said that.
I remember telling a reporter that I used to get whippings every day from my grandmother. And this reporter said to me, oh, you were abused. I said, no, I wasn't abused. I just got whippings every day. Oh, how devastating. How did you survive? Have you had, you know, therapy? Therapy? No, you got your butt whipped every day, and that was your therapy. But it's just a part, or was at the time, a part of the black culture. So, yeah, I think too much has been made of born on the Mississippi farm with corn cob dolls and no shoes till she was seven, sent to live with her parents, broken home, separated, mother was a maid, ran away from home, was going to be put into detention home. Devastating, devastating. So I think I am blessed because I have come from a varied background, you know, living with my mother for a while, living with my grandmother for a while, living with my father. And I never had a day of therapy because I always knew who I was. When I got my first job in broadcasting, I was 17 years old, asked to speak and record some news copy for this radio station to hear my voice on tape. Well, I'd been reading and orating since I was three, so I was just as confident as I could be. It was like another another stage for me. Yes, sir, I can read, and was hired on the spot.
Two TV stations later, she came to Chicago to host a third-rated morning program. Within a few months, AM Chicago was number one in the Windy City and renamed the Oprah Winfrey Show. After all, that's what people were calling it anyway.
I'm Oprah Winfrey, and welcome to the very first National Oprah Winfrey Show!
Last fall, the Oprah Winfrey Show went national. 138 markets across the country, an unprecedented number of cities, signed on for the daytime premiere. But national attention is not unfamiliar to Oprah Winfrey. Some of you may have seen her first on the game show, The Dating Game.
Her worst dating experience, well, when she had to ask her date to leave his purse in the car because it was bigger than hers. That's it. Please welcome Oprah Winfrey.
But what is worse is when you meet Mr. Right and the timing is all wrong. Her current boyfriend has to put up with a woman who works most of her waking hours.
What happens is, you go through life and you say, Lord, please send me a man. And then people say, child, just take it easy now. You will find yourself a man when you stop looking for one. And so you go through this part of your life where you say, okay, I'm not looking. Okay. So you walk into the room and you say, not looking, but maybe he's here. Maybe he's behind the camera. Maybe that's him over there. So I sort of stopped looking, and then Stedman came along, and then I realized I don't have the time anyway.
Why don't you marry him?
Very secure. Now, see there, Monica, I knew she's going to go meddling in my personal
life.
That's
right. You do it with everybody else, I'll do it with you. Why don't you marry him?
I think that marriage is such an incredible commitment to make. You got to know what you're doing. And because I've done talk shows for so long, I know the mistakes that other people have made. And so I would want to know that it's absolutely, positively it. So I'm not ready for this whole commitment.
And her time is becoming more valuable to others outside the television business. It all started one morning when producer Quincy Jones saw Oprah on Chicago television. A phone call to film director Steven Spielberg resulted in a plum role in his film, The Color Purple.
Oh, this here is Sophia. Sophia, that's a pretty name, huh? Sophia. I was gonna get married.
Look like you got yourself in trouble.
No, sir, I ain't in no trouble. Big though.
Who the daddy?
Hoppo.
How he know that?
He know cause he's the only one.
For this role, Oprah Winfrey was nominated for an Academy Award. And there's more. A lead in a movie released just this month, native son. Oprah plays the mother of Bigger Thomas, who is about to be hung for an accidental death.
Son, is there anything I can do? Anything?
I'm all right.
I want you to have this. Ain't nobody but God can stop your suffering now.
Why is acting your second love? Although it's
not even a second love. It's really my first love. I'd rather act than eat. Now that is a, listen, you heard it here first. I would rather act than eat.
I don't believe it.
Yeah, it's the truth. It's the only thing I'd rather do than eat, but that's it. That's it. If I could like act, if someone said to me, I will let you act from now on the rest of your life, I would lose my thighs. I mean, really, I would give up my thighs for the ability to act every day. As a kid, growing up, I was always like pulling little stunts.
If it seems as if Oprah has always gotten her way, you may be right. It has to do with her peculiar philosophy about life, a philosophy that has helped her through poverty in the South to become a self-made millionaire.
You have no power over me or my life. You only have power over yours, which is really the reason why I do this show, too, because I want people to understand that you are responsible for your life, whether you are transsexual, whether you're a divorcee, whether you're terminally ill, whether you are possessed by the devil or trying to get the devil out of you. You have control over your life, and it is only when you recognize that and are willing to be responsible for your life that you can truly soar. And I believe that it's possible in our lifetime to fly if you want to. I intend to do some flying. Mm-hmm.
I think you're kind of doing it now.
I've been doing some flying.